for those cases in the Schrödinger equation, where in the configuration we have two particles close to each other, or three particles close to each other. This is the task that we need to do now. I mean, already yesterday I gave some argument that for those cases when we have two particles close to each other and one particle separately, this wave function satisfies the Schrödinger equation. I mean, my argument was the following, that here the two-body scattering is taken into account by the terms. I mean, we have altogether six terms, but we can group the six terms according to three pairings, which pair we take here and which particle we have separately. And in each pair, in each pair, the two-body scattering is correctly taken into account by these S vectors. I mean, this is how we constructed the wave function. So actually, for all types of cases when we have two particles separate from another one particle, I mean, immediately follows that this is the Schrödinger equation is satisfied. I mean, clearly it is also satisfied for those cases when there is one particle to the left and two particles here. You can think about it, and this is satisfied. Nevertheless, it is useful to write down the Schrödinger equation for this particular component, or this particular component of the equation that we get, because we can use it for the three-body problem. And the three-body problem is the new situation when we have those components in the Schrödinger equation where three particles occupy just neighboring positions. And then we need to make a separate analysis whether it is a good solution, exact solution or not. And for this one, we really need to write down the equations please be patient. I mean, we need to write out what we have. And okay, so we keep this in our head, or on YouTube you can divine later, but now I need 2 days because I only have one whiteboard. So we will focus on these cases and these cases. So I erase it, and we need to write down the equations, okay? So, well, how much space do I need? I'm not completely certain. We will see. I keep this one, and then we will see how it looks like. So Schrödinger equation, for example, for this type of configuration is the following. I mean, energy multiplied by C of, how should I write it? Maybe I write x1 plus 1 and x3, where I just made a substitution that x2 is equal to x1 plus 1, which is this configuration. Now, what do we have here? There is a 1/2, like before. This 1/2 comes from this 1/2 here. And then we have action of these permutation operators and this identity, I mean, something like this. When you think about it, the only thing which will contribute to this component is when we act with the two-side operator here, and then corresponding separately to the one particle position, wherever it is. Corresponding to the two particle cases, we get, on the one hand side, we get C of x1 minus 1, x1 plus 1, and x3. Plus we get C of x1 plus 2, x3. Then plus, then minus, I continue here, sorry, I mean, it's maybe a little bit messy, but there is not enough space. I continue here, minus 2 times psi of x1 plus 1 and x3. So this minus 2 comes from this minus 1 here, that we act with here and here. Now these are the terms when these operators, two side operators, act somehow around these two particles, and then separately it also acts here. I will just write it down. So there's C of x1 plus 1 and x3 minus 1 plus C at x1 plus 1 and x3 plus 1, and maybe this is dead.
Where is my other blue?
x3 plus 1 minus 2 times, I erase this one, minus 2 times psi at x1 plus 1 and x3. And I close it. And this is now opening of big bracket. And I argued already that this part of the Schrödinger equation is satisfied, because this is how we constructed two-body scattering and the whole wave function built upon two-body scattering.
Balázs, sorry, can you please write better when the was fading away?
Yes, so psi x1 plus, I mean, it's not good this way. So this was psi x1 x1 plus 1 and x3 minus 1 plus psi x1, x1 plus 1 and x3 plus 1 and then minus. Is it good?
Yeah, now we can see.
Okay. Okay. So this is one equation for these types of configurations. And now we need to look at the equation for these types of configurations. And actually this equation will be very simple. I mean, when you think about it, these two side operators, where do they act? You will immediately get that they only act on the beginning somehow here and here, because this is where something non-trivial happens. I mean, when the two side operator corresponding to these two sides acts, it acts with zero, and here it also acts with zero. And otherwise it also acts with zero. So the Schrodinger equation for this component is energy multiplied by psi x1, I write it like this, x1 plus 1 and x1, no, I cannot write, x1 plus 2 is equal 1 half bracket. On one hand side, I have c of x1 minus 1, x1 plus 1, x1 plus 2, then plus c of x1, x1 plus 1, x1 plus 3, because from here, when it jumps, minus 2 times psi x1, x1 plus 1, and x1 plus 2. And now we need to check whether our ansatz, what we had in the earlier version of the whiteboard, whether this ansatz satisfies this equation, because this is the only new equation for the three particle case. And now we have multiple methods. I mean, first method is again brute force. So you take the formula that was here, you substitute, and then you will see that it is satisfied. I'm not doing it. I mean, if you really want, you can do it at home yourself. It will be satisfied by this equation. Now we can also do a trick, which is a little bit better, I would say. We use again this argument, which is a tricky argument, that the formal structure of this equation does not really care about the relative position of the x1 and x3. I mean, because we take a functional form, we substitute, and it is satisfied for every x1, x3. It is just a matter of our basis that x3 has to be separate from x1 plus 1. So we take this equation, and here we satisfy, here we substitute x1, 3 is x1 plus 2. We substitute this here, we get a different equation from this one, and we take the difference. When we take the difference, then these two terms cancel, and we get again some terms which do not cancel. And we need to look at these terms which do not cancel. And if you do it carefully, I did it myself, and I hope it's not mistaken, you should check it at home. When you check it carefully, I don't want to spend time with it. The new equation what we get is that C of x1 plus 1, x1 plus 1, and x1 plus 2, plus C of x1, x1, and x1 plus 2 is equal 2 times C of x1, x1 plus 1, and x1 plus 2. I mean, really, please check. Then you can believe that this is working. So this is a simple. And if this is satisfied, then if we also use this one, then we get a satisfaction of this one. Now, we should check whether this is satisfied by our ansatz. And I can argue that it is satisfied by our ansatz. And my argument is basically the same what we had here. Namely, the last coordinate is x1 plus 2 in all the cases. So there is only a little bit of change first two coordinates, because here we have this x1 plus 1 plus 1, here just x1, x1, and x1 and x1 plus 1. And remember that for the two-body case, we had the same type of relation, but as was the third coordinate was not present. And this is how we constructed the two-body wave function. And now the three-body wave function can be organized as three sums, a sum of three terms, such that each term we can group two pairs together and with their relative position exchange, setting them on the first two positions. Actually, I should show here, on the first two positions. And when we group the coordinates with the ansatz wave function in this way, then this equation is satisfied. Because the third coordinate is just a spectator coordinate, it is not changed. And with this argument, I have shown that the Bethe ansatz wave function is a good wave function, even for these components of the Schrodinger equation. So it is an exact wave function for the three-body problem. And now I will pause for a moment because this is a big success, so to say. And I need to stress this big success somehow. So this was the big discovery of Bethe, that the scattering in these models really factorized, and the three-body problem can be described by a succession of two-body scatterings. We will encounter this phenomenon many times, even later in this lecture course. Now I just say that I stress again that we made an ansatz, and it was verified to be true. And we see this notion of factorized scattering. And with this notion, you can argue further that if you extend the whole idea to three-body, from three-body to four-body, you can really think about it. You can prove inductively that it will be a good exact wave function for arbitrary particle numbers. So let me now dive down the solution for arbitrary particle numbers, and also then we will discuss the periodic boundary conditions. So I delete this one, and I start anew. So I say that we want to construct a coordinate wave function on coordinates x1, etc., xn, with the condition that x1 is smaller than x2, etc., smaller than xn. And I describe the coordinate Bethe ansatz wave function with a collection of momenta, which are p1 until pn. It's an ordered set of momenta. And then I write the following. I write the summation over permutations. Sn is the permutation group of n particles, and I denote by sigma the permutation. I have a summation over permutations. Then what I write an exponential factor, e to the I, and then what do? I write here a sum over j, which goes from 1 to m. Maybe it's not visible. I'm sorry, I will write it separately here. I want it to be visible. So this is equal to sum over permutations, this is sigma. Now I write it like this, s, I, and then here I have sum j goes from 1 to n, and then I have coordinate xj multiplied by p of, I write it like this, sigma j. So sigma is a permutation, and sigma j is a result of permutation. And then this is multiplied by a phase, and this phase consists of scattering factors, like before. And how do we construct the scattering factors? So we consider each pair, j and k, we consider each pair, and for each pair we investigate whether in this permutation there was a change or there was no change. So we have the product for those pairs where j is smaller than k, but sigma j, the result of the permutation, is bigger than sigma k. So this means that for this particular permutation, the particle j was scattered on the particle k in some imaginary scattering process. And then in the S matrix or S matrix vector, scattering factor, I write lambda j minus lambda k. And this is the coordinate Bethe ansatz wave function for general particle numbers n. And it is valid, it is an exact wave function for infinite volume where I can choose any p momenta. I mean, the wave function has to be normalizable, so not completely, not any. For the moment, let us just say that the pj are real momenta for the moment. We will go to complex momenta in a second. This is fine. And then what else? We should go back to finite volume, L finite. And then in finite volume, we find again periodicity conditions. And in the general case, the periodicity condition is as follows. Psi at zero and x2, etc., xn, should be equal to psi at x2, etc., xn, and L. Very similar to what we had in the two-body case. Now you take this wave function, you substitute this periodicity condition, and then you will see, I mean, you will get many terms for the Fourier coefficients of this equation, but actually you will only get n independent conditions, and these n independent conditions are the so-called beta equations. And they describe periodicity property with respect to the particle separately. I will not do this computation of substituting these two here. Again, you can do it at home. It's useful to look at it, I mean, at least for three particles. I will now give you the heuristic argument of what the beta equations are. And it's very similar to the two-body case. So you have this circle, periodic boundary conditions, and you have the spins, and you have the particles, which are the downspins, and you have some number of particles which are there. And you take one particle, an arbitrary particle, pj, and then you move it around the volume. And the wave function should not be, should be single valued. So the phase accumulated when you move this particle around the volume should add up to zero multiple of 2 pi. And then what you get is you get a free particle propagation phase, which is ipj multiplied by L. And then you have a product of scattering phases when this particle scatters on all of the other particles. So you have a product over k not equal to j, so all the other particles not equal to the same particle that you consider. And then I write s of lambda j minus lambda k, and this is equal to 1. And you can write down the equation for every particle. So you have actually a set of n equations where j goes from 1 to n. And these equations are called the Bethe equations. Again, what do we need to substitute here? S function was computed from two-body scattering. It was in the previous lecture. And the p is also known as a function of lambda. It was also given in the previous lecture. So in this sense, this is a set of coupled algebraic relation for the set of rapidities lambda 1, etc., lambda n. And as we discussed at the end, there was a very good question. When you actually want to find numerical values for this, it's a very complicated problem. And I also can give you a comment here, it just comes to my mind, that even mathematicians are interested in the Bethe equations. From the point of view of algebraic geometry, there are papers appearing on this, but they show that it is connected to, I don't want to say stupid things because I don't know those papers, but some theories in algebraic geometry. Maybe for the next lecture, I can look at one example. It is just an exotic thing that such a simple thing from many-body physics, data and that solution of one-dimensional magnetism is related to some exotic and complicated mathematical structures. Or at least it's complicated to me because I'm not an expert there. Maybe they would say that our physics is complicated. So I don't know about that. In any case, this was the general Bethe Ansatz wave function and Bethe equations. And now we should go and start to analyze these equations a little bit closer. We still have time. We have maybe 20 minutes is gone from this lecture. So we go to the analysis of the Bethe equations, and we go a little bit closer to see what type of values these rapidities can assume. I can put forward that eventually we will be interested in the antiferromagnetic ground state and maybe excitations above the antiferromagnetic ground state. But for the moment, we will just consider situations with low particle numbers. So we will consider situations when we have a finite volume L. It can be, you can think it's an intermediate volume like 10, 20, 100. And we have a couple of particles. We have 1, 2, 3, or 4 particles as we have here. And we want to look at what are the possibilities for the solutions of Bethe equations. Later we will go to the antiferromagnetic ground state and we will study it. But also for the thermodynamic area, but this is only later. So I will erase it. And actually, we start, so to say, from the beginning, but now we go to the study of the solutions and the possibilities. We go back to the beginning and we go back to one particles. This is very simple. The Bethe Ansatz condition was e to the I pi L is equal 1, and solutions are p 2 pi over L multiplied by integer quantum number. This is a number of set. This is very simple. And also the rapidities corresponding to these solutions, they will be real numbers. However, already at two particles, we have a more complicated situation. You can imagine that the equations will have solutions where lambda 1 and lambda 2 are real numbers. Correspondingly, p1 and p2 are real numbers. There will be lots of solutions corresponding to this most natural choice, but this is not the only choice. There are also complex solutions, and I will now show that it is possible to write down a completely meaningful Bethe Ansatz wave function where these parameters are complex numbers. How should we approach it? Well, first, let me Let me just simply write down the beta equation again for the two particles. Very simple. E to the I P1L multiplied by S. S lambda 1, 2 is equal 1, and E to I P2L multiplied by S lambda 2, 1 is equal 1. Now I multiply the two equations and this cancels, the relative scattering cancels. What I get after multiplication is E to the I P1 plus P2L is equal 1. And we see that from this, the quantization condition for the center of mass momentum is basically the same as here. So for the center of mass momentum, or total momentum, I have that this should be equal to 2 pi over L, and again some number, I don't know, I tilde or whatever. It's not important. But this is an integer number. So the sum of the two momenta has to be real, but maybe it is possible to have complex conjugate solutions. So we want to look and we want to understand what happens. Can we have solutions where P1 is actually P2 star, but they are not real? And when you look at the function of P as a function of lambda, the rapidities, you will see that it's a real analytic function. So this also means that lambda 1 should be complex conjugate of lambda 2. So how should we write it? We want to investigate these solutions, and then I will write it like I will erase it and I will make new whiteboard. I open a new slide, so to say. So I write that P1 should be equal to PC plus I times I want to write minus actually. So PC minus I tau, and P2 should be PC plus I tau, complex conjugate solutions, and PC PC and tau are real, and C stands for center. So it is somehow center of mass momentum, but I mean, the total momentum is 2 PC now. And then, correspondingly, I will also write that lambda 1 is lambda C. I will write minus I kappa. And lambda 2 is equal to lambda C plus I kappa. And we want to understand what are the possibilities for the PC and the tau, and or correspondingly, what are the possibilities for lambda C and kappa. And the physical, I can put forward that the physics that we will investigate here is bound state formation. I mean, again, this is very basic textbook material, so to say, but let us go through it, okay? Because, I mean, at least one time it is important, I would say, or very useful to go into details. So the wave function, the exact wave function what we had is the following, e to the I P1 x1 plus P2 x2 plus S of lambda 1, 2 times e to the I P2 x1 plus P1 x2. And now we substitute these formulas. Let me just simply substitute this case here. From this factor, what do I get? I mean, I get e to the I. Now, for PC, we will have x1 and x2. So I will have PC times x1 plus x2. And then for the tau, what do I get? I mean, for x1, I have minus I tau. And for x2, I have plus I tau. So I will write it like this, plus I tau x2 minus x1. And I can also write it, I can pull this I outside, so I will write it as I e to the I PC times x1 plus x2 multiplied by e to the now minus I times I is minus tau x2 minus x1. So what does this describe? I mean, here we have wave propagation of center of mass, so to say, and here we have an exponentially decaying wave function in the relative coordinate. And it's very important to remember that x1 is smaller than x2. So this is a positive number. This is a positive number. So this is strongly decaying, so to say. I mean, strongly depending on tau, of course. But I assume that tau is a, this is well behaving. Okay, I didn't say. This is well behaving if tau is equal to zero or bigger than zero. Because if tau is smaller than zero, then this is a wave function which blows up and it's not physical. When I talk about blowing up, let me say that first I want to go to infinite volume. I mean, we will return to finite volume first, but I want to investigate complex solutions in infinite volume. it is also possible. Maybe I should have started with saying this comment, but it is also possible to go to infinite volume and study the same thing. And then in infinite volume, I mean, this would blow up if tau would be negative. So tau should be positive. It has to be positive, otherwise it is completely not physical. But then the problem is that we go on and here we have S lambda 2, and here we have exchanged the momenta. So we would have the same scattering factor for the center of mass, Pc times x1 plus x2, but here we would have e to the tau with positive coefficient x2 minus x1. Yeah, I mean, I could also say in other words that I cannot have exponential decay in both terms. And this is already a term where I cannot do anything. I mean, in this normalization, this is completely fixed. So if I choose tau bigger than zero, then this would blow up when two particles come further away from each other. And the only possibility to have a meaningful wave function where this term does not cause problems is to use the freedom what we have here on S. So we have the condition that this will not blow up if we have a strict condition that S lambda 1 minus lambda 2 should be zero. I mean, in other terms, this is also equivalent to having S lambda 2 minus lambda 1 is equal to infinity. So the rapidity difference has to be on the pole of, there should be a pole of the wave function or equivalent to zero, not wave function, pole of the S matrix, equivalent to a pole of zero of the S matrix, which can give us this very convenient effect that this will completely be zero. And then we have a perfectly fine wave function, which is a wave function of bound states. Clearly it's a bound state because wave function has a finite value when two particles are close to each other, but it decays when the two particles come further away from each other. It is a bound state of two spin waves. Now let us look then at this condition.
Sorry.
Yeah?
Sorry, I just a bit lost. It's S equal to zero to infinity. I guess zero.
So it's exchanged. So
we have, okay, yes, okay. This is, it's two. Okay.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Yes. And I think many of you have heard, I mean, these general statements that we have a bound state in the theory if the S matrix has a pole or a zero. I mean, this comes from general scattering theory, even in quantum field theory, particle physics. So now we have this luxury that we can investigate this process in full detail on the level of Bethe Ansatz wave function. So that's somehow the beauty of the whole theory, that we can take some phenomena which is existent and very well known in other models, but here we can really see all the details and compute it explicitly. So the S matrix is known. Let us see then what this is. I mean, lambda 1 minus lambda 2 in this description is minus 2i kappa. And S matrix was known. So let me write down what is it. I mean, S of minus 2i kappa is the following. We computed the S matrix in last lecture. So this is minus 2i kappa. Now here was plus I over minus 2i kappa, and here was minus I. And this gives us that the condition that if this is zero, then we get kappa should be equal to one half. It is completely fixed to one half. So I can also divide the lambda one and lambda two. I apologize. I mean, I'll try to just put it here for simplicity. So lambda one should be lambda center minus I over two, and lambda should be lambda center plus I over two. Lambda center describes the center of the two rapidities. All right, now we are making good progress, and then we can already see that I will now erase what we don't need. Please keep in mind that this was the general case, but we set this to zero. So I will erase it. I mean, for me, this is simpler this way. So I will erase it. And then this is our wave function. Now let us still compute something in this wave function. I want to rewrite it this form using the lambdas, and then we can just read off something. So I want to rewrite e to the I pi 1 using the lambda 1 and e to the I pi 2 using lambda 2. So I will write for lambda 1, we have lambda c minus I over 2 minus I over 2 over the lambda c minus I over 2 plus I over 2. I mean, just to be clear, okay, I repeat here. So the e to the I pi was lambda minus I over 2 over lambda plus I over 2. And now what I do is I take this function and I substitute these two cases. So additional shifts. This is what I put here. To the power of x1 multiplied by, I can already write what I will have is lambda c plus 1, but it will like be like this, and then the lambda c plus I multiplied by to the power of x2. Okay, and I will rewrite it in the following form. I want to rewrite it as lambda c minus I over lambda c plus I to the power of x1 plus x2. And then what will be missing? I mean, there will be some things missing. This part is correct. It will be already given there. This part is correct. What do I want to do? I will get, on the one hand side, I will get lambda c to the power of x2 minus x1 from this and this. And then there will be the additional parts which is not correctly counted. So let me check. I should have here lambda c plus, this is correct. This is correct completely, right? I mean, this part is correct here. And then what is not correct is, I am a little bit lost. What did I make wrong? No. It should be minus I, because we should. I am sorry, I'm a little bit lost at the moment.
Maybe can you just repeat what you are trying to do? I got lost. What's the motivation?
I'm sorry. The motivation is simply just I want to express this wave function in the remaining part in x1 and x2. Using these two lambdas, but I want to have a. I don't know why I have this freeze at the moment. So I just expressed e to the I p one using lambda one. This is this right, and to the power of x one, and I also expressed e to the p two using lambda two, and this is what is written here. And then what I want to do is separate the center of mass and the relative coordinate. Okay, so let me check once again, what did I do wrong? I mean, lambda c x2 minus x1, this is correct. So what is wrong that here I should put lambda c minus I to the power of x2, because this is not there. And then also, what should I? And then I should also put here lambda c. Plus I to the power of x1, but it's not what I wanted. Okay, forget it. I'm sorry, I went into some mistake. I'm sorry about this. I will do something simpler. I mean, the sampling simpler is just to look at the relative coordinate, the propagation of the relative. When I increase x1 and x2 with just one. So I just take product of e to the I p1 multiplied by e to the I p2. Now this is the product of, now I substitute this, then I get lambda c minus I over lambda c. And then here I get lambda c over lambda c plus one. I made a mistake with the relative coordinate. Somehow it was not what I wanted, but maybe I had something wrong in my mind. In any case, this is clear. So this is the propagation factor for the center of mass when we propagate both particles with one. Clearly, this is the one. And then this cancels, and we get lambda c minus I over lambda c plus I. And then you can see that this is very similar to this formula. I can call it the e to the I p, but p, the big p is somehow 2pc. It is the total momentum of the bound state, and for the total momentum or total lattice momentum of the bound state, we get this formula. Very similar to this one, but a little bit different. It's I minus I and plus I. What do we get for the total energy? This is also important. Total energy for the of the ground state. I mean, total energy of the bound state is E of lambda one plus E of lambda two. And then I have the E function, the energy function, one particle energy function. This was also in the last lecture. As a function of lambda, this is 1/2 and 1 over lambda squared plus 1/4. This was also in the last lecture. Now I take these two values for lambda 1 and lambda 2, I add them up, and what do I get? I mean, this is, again, a simple exercise. You can pull this into so-called, how is it called, fractionals, what is it in English? I mean, you can pull this apart according to the poles, or anyways, you can just pull the two things together with a common denominator and some things will cancel, and then you will get something simple. You will get 1 over lambda squared plus 1 with a minus, and I think the coefficient is just simply 1, but let me check my notes. Yes, I mean, this is correct. I mean, again, this is a homework. I mean, very simply put this formula into here, and then you will get it after putting it, pulling it together. And I can also express this function using the EIP actually, or using simply from the P, and then you get this very simple formula that this will be equal to minus sine square of big P over two. And this is again remarkable that the functional form of the bound state energy with respect to the bound state total momentum is very similar to what we have in the single particle case. And in the single particle case, we had in the previous lecture that this is equal to minus 2 sine square p over 2. This was in the previous lecture. It's very similar, but now we don't have minus 2, we just have a minus. So in terms of the using the momentum, somehow the energy is a little bit smaller.
Balázs, sorry, should be, also there is a question in the chat, should be lambda c in the denominator, I guess.
Of course, yes, thank you very much. Yes, thank you, I didn't know this.
Sorry, hi, I have a question. Are these bound states anywhere to be found in the complex plane, or are you constraining your complex plane in some way?
Yeah, that's a good question. We will just go there, because so far this was, as I said, infinite volume. And now when we go to finite volume, then we can figure out what are the possibilities for lambda c. I mean, what we had so far is that they should be complex conjugate, and lambda c should be, I mean, real, it is clear. But then we should also determine what is the possibility for lambda c. Is this an answer?
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Okay. And then we find this lambda c, okay, I mean, I can just answer just now, because you remember one blackboard or not whiteboard before, we had the condition that for the total momentum, the condition is the same as in the one particle case. So we have the condition that e to the, I divide it here, and hopefully it is still visible, e to the I p1 plus p2 multiplied by l is equal to one. And now we computed what is the product of the two propagation factors using the lambda c. It is this function. So this will be actually equal to, okay, I erased this one, I'm sorry. It's really not enough space. So this is equal to lambda c minus I over lambda c plus I to the power of L, and this is equal to one. And then this equation tells you what are the lambda c's possibilities. I mean, clearly this is a, okay, root of unity, and then you can find what is lambda c, what are possibilities of lambda c. Okay?
Excuse me. On the exponential, is ip plus x?
Sorry, I p1 plus p2.
Oh, okay.
Multiplied by L. So these are the possibilities what you get for lambda c, and it determines the so-called center. And I can also put forward, I mean, before we move on, that such solutions are called string solutions or Bethe strings. They are strings because I will just go on to the, I mean, higher particle case. They lie in a complex plane where we have difference of I in the imaginary direction, or approximately equal to I. And then what we have is, well, it's called string solution. So here what we have is a two-string, so-called two-string. It's just a name. And before we go to the break, I have 2 minutes. And in these 2 minutes, I don't want to discuss higher particle level, but higher particle cases. But I want to go back to finite volume. And this will be actually very simple. So I want to now use all of this information what we have here and make a little modification so that we can go back to finite volume. So I erase this one. And now length is not infinite, but L is finite. Okay. And in finite volume, what changes? I mean, in finite volume, when you would have something like this, you imagine somehow, but in this argument, what we had here is not valid anymore, because our argument was that this would be an exponentially blowing up function, but in a finite volume, it cannot blow up completely. I mean, because in finite volume, the difference between x1 and x2 is limited. I mean, it cannot go to infinity. So there is no problem if this term is finite, if it is there. So, but instead what we have, that the beta roots have to satisfy the beta equations. And then it turns out that typically, I mean, sometimes this is also an option, but typically this is not what we get. We get a little modification. So let me delete this one. We get a little modification to this string solution. It turns out that in finite volume, what we get typically is that I add here a plus I delta, and I add here a minus I delta. And this delta is called so-called string deviation. So the string position would be minus I over 2 and plus I over 2 if it would be an infinite volume. This is the exact string, so to say. But if we go to finite volume, it is changed a little bit. It is changed symmetrically because we still have a complex conjugate there. And now this delta has to be determined from the beta equations. So now both terms will be finite. I mean, one is exponentially decreasing, decreasing, and this is exponentially increasing, but altogether they combine to something which is periodic, and then we need beta equations to fix this delta. Let me just keep 1 minute, because this will be actually simpler. It is equal to look at one equation, because the two beta equations will give essentially the same thing for this delta. So I write e to the I p1l is equal to s lambda 1, by multiplied by s lambda 1, 2 is equal to 1. I substitute the things. So I take p1 from this function that I had before. So I write that lambda c minus I over 2 plus I delta minus I over 2 over lambda c minus I over 2 plus I delta plus I over 2 to the power of l. And then this is multiplied by the s evaluated at the difference. Now the difference is minus I plus 2i delta. So this I write into the S matrix. So I write S matrix vector minus I plus 2i delta. And then here I have plus I over minus I plus 2i delta minus I. And this is equal to 1. Let us make now some simplifications. So simplification is I just add up the I factors together. So here I have lambda c minus I plus I delta over lambda c plus I delta to the power of L. And here I add everything together and I delete the I, because actually I delete 2i. So I will get delta just there, it's like this. And here I will get delta minus 1, because this is minus 2i and I delete 2i. This is equal to 1. Now my statement is that typically the behavior of this equation when L goes to infinity or big volumes is very easy to find, because delta, we make an assumption which is that will be turn out to be true, that delta is a small number. If delta is a small number, then you can look here, this will be a small number because delta can be neglected besides minus one. And when you look here, this will be a factor which in magnitude is bigger than one. So I make an approximation that delta is much smaller than one. This will turn out to be a good approximation when volume is very large. Then I can make some simplifications. So I will neglect this one. So I make an approximation that I will just write delta, and here I will write minus one. This is minus one of here. And here I make a simplification that delta is already small, and I assume that lambda c is some finite value. It's just an assumption, but for the moment, let us assume that lambda c is not equal to zero. Then what I get is lambda c minus I over lambda c to the power of L. And we multiply this together, and from this you can see that when L is increased to bigger and bigger volumes, the magnitude of this term will actually grow. I mean, it has a phase. So lambda c is real, and this combination has a phase. But when you add the complex minus I to the real number, that altogether the magnitude of this one is bigger than one. And this will be exponentially increasing when L goes to infinity. So delta has to be exponentially decreasing. Delta can be approximated by minus lambda c over lambda c minus I to the power of L, where lambda c is determined from the previous equation from free wave function. For the center of mass. And maybe here I will stop, maybe I'm in 4 minutes over the time. Let me just summarize that delta is a string deviation. It is exponentially small in finite volume. And when we go to infinite volume, then actually it will become zero. And we get back to the previous case what we had from infinite volume. So thank you, this is for the first lecture.
Okay, do there are questions?
Could you explain for me again why you call this a string solution? I didn't really get this.
Yes, this will be after 10 minutes when we go to the second lecture. it will be clear when we go to three particles and four particles. I mean, you will just see that the situation will be very similar. I mean, I can draw it now, and then I don't need to do it for the next lecture. The situation will be like this, that you can have real solutions which are on the real line. Okay, so this is complex plane, and I want to draw what are possibilities for solutions. And if you were in two particle case, you can have two solutions which are on the real line, or which are separated like this, where the difference between them is I plus this small deviation. And when you go to three particles, you can have different possibilities, but one possibility is the so-called three string, where the three particles are sitting like this, such that each of these differences is I. So it's an imaginary direction one unit. And you can go to four or five particles, and it's very similar like this. So that you will have, generally, you can have a bound state of any number of fundamental spin waves. But in this bound state, the position of the beta roots will be such that the differences are always I in the imaginary direction. And each pair has to sit on the pole or zero of the S matrix. And when you look at the combination, that it will be a good wave function and a good bound state. The bound state of n particles, if we are talking about n string. Okay, now is this okay?
Yeah, very good.
This is now we save some time from the second lecture today.
I think let's reconvene in, I would say, 10 minutes.
Yes, thank you. Okay.
Later.
I can start if you want. I don't know. I mean, should we wait?
For me, it's okay. I think we can start.
Okay, so I think, yeah. So first, let me just go back to the stupid thing what I messed up here. I mean, just what I wanted to do. I mean, it's very simple, but I messed up a factor of two somehow. So what I wanted to write is e to the I p1 x1 plus p to x2, and I just write it. I just wanted the rewriting in terms of center of mass and relative coordinate. And then you can write that this is equal to e to the I p1 plus p2 times x1 plus x2 over 2 multiplied by e to the, let's not mess it up again, I p1 over e to the I p2, difference, I write it like this, to the power of x1 minus x2 over 2. Yeah. Maybe I should put more beautifully here. To the power of x1 minus x2 over 2. I mean, this is what I wanted to write, and then you write the functions e to the I p1 and e to the I p2, you express them using lambda 1 and lambda 2, what we had earlier, and then you get the motion for center of mass. And here the motion is described by the function what we had earlier, this e to the I p, which is equal to lambda center minus e lambda center plus e, right? And in the relative coordinate, you get a function which is such that it altogether it will be exponentially decreasing when x2 is bigger than x1. Anyway, I messed it up a little bit, but you can do it in homework. Well, I mean, checking it, I'm sorry, but this is very simple. I don't know, somehow I just messed up this vector of 1/2 or something. Okay. And okay, so I can just come back to this answer of this previous question, what was at the end of the previous lecture, now namely about n strings. So when we go to higher particle numbers, this is a statement. It's a statement that you can check when you go to details. I mean, I do not investigate the details, but the statement is that there are so-called n string solutions, which are such that for any integer n, they are such that we have n. In the complex space, somehow we have n roots which are centered around the real line, such that approximately each difference is equal to I, but there are some string deviations. So the whole set is complex conjugate of each itself, so they are symmetrically placed around the real axis, but there can be string deviations. String deviations depend on the volume, but they are exponentially small if you go to bigger and bigger volume. It's important that in infinite volume, the exact string is such that all these differences are I. So if you have an even number of particles, then they will be symmetrically placed and nobody is on the real line. But if you have an odd number of particles in the bound state, then there will be somebody sitting on the real line. And then usually we just call this symmetric point the string center of this string solution. And for each string solution, we can compute also the total momentum and total energy. This is an easy exercise. I mean, also homework for those of you who are interested in the details. So the total momentum of an n string is computed to be string center minus I over, how is it? I times n over 2. I know it by heart, but I just made a small mistake. Over lambda c plus I n over 2. I mean, the original real solutions are correspond to n equals 1. One string is a real solution. I mean, earlier we computed in detail the two string. And then this was just minus I and this plus I. And generally we get this. I really recommend that those of you who want to understand the details to compute this. Total momentum should be e to the I, p1 plus p2, blah, 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 until pn, where each of them is given by the lambdas. And the lambdas are placed like this on the complex plane. You will get some cancellations, and from the cancellations, you get this. And the total energy, which is given as a sum over the individual energies, plus plus e to the p n in the n string, this is computed to be something simple. And let me just look at the final result. I mean, normalization, prefactors are important, so I don't want to mess it up. So this is minus 1/2 and n over lambda center squared plus n squared over 4. And when you express this using center of total momentum, sorry, then you get minus 2 over n times sine squared big P over 2. So the functional form on the total momentum is the same as before, but energy is smaller and smaller. And I mean, in magnitude. And there is an explanation for this, why the energy is smaller and smaller. I mean, the explanation is that in the bound state, you have particles which are still somehow close to each other. And remember that our spin chain is completely anti-ferromagnetic. So the biggest energy gain you get when you have some particles which are separated from each other. Then you have complete anti-ferromagnetism, because then you have these neighboring positions completely free when you have this energy gain from anti-ferromagnetic configurations. But when particles are close to each other, then there are some contributions to the wave function where downspins are close to each other, particles are on neighboring sides, downspins are on neighboring sides, and it's not so favorable. That's why, I mean, this is the intuitive explanation why we have this 2 over n here. Why energy gain is smaller when we go to bigger and bigger bound states. And in terms of physical behavior, this also means that the bound states are somehow heavier. Heavy here means that propagation speed will be smaller. We will talk about propagation speed a little bit later, but propagation speed of bound states is typically smaller. They are heavy particles. The fastest particles are the one strings, which are the original spin gauge, not bound. So, and okay, these are n strings, but what happens if we get an arbitrary n particle solution of the Bethe equations? How does the solution look like? N particle solution. And the statement is that it is called, I mean, the statement that I want to say now is for the string hypothesis. And I will discuss it in a lot of detail, not a lot of detail, in some detail now. The statement says that if you have a generic n particle solution, it will consist typically of a collection of these strings. So typically, when you have lambda 1, et cetera, lambda big n, which is solution to beta equations in some finite volume L, and you plot them in the complex plane, then you will get a collection of these strings. Maybe many one strings, maybe some two strings, et cetera, such that the total number of beta roots has to be equal, of course, big N. But you can have typically you can have arbitrary types of bound states in the complex plane with arbitrary string centers, and the string centers are also determined by beta equations. And okay, this is called the string hypothesis. And I will talk about this in a little bit later, because it's important that this is hypothesis and it is not rigorously proven. And also, I mean, in order to rigorously prove, you should make more rigorous statements, formulate this hypothesis in a mathematical term. But this is an observation. I mean, you go to small volumes and you go to somehow bigger and bigger volumes. So like volume 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, and then you investigate all solutions of beta equations, you will see that most states satisfy this pattern, okay? There will be some outlier states. There will be some states where behavior is slightly different. And now that's why I want to make some statements, and I want to make some kind of, I want to make those statements which are actually strong statements. So I will delete this and some statements about beta equations and their solutions. So first statement, and this is rigorous. If you have collection of beta roots, which are solution to the beta equations, then this set has to be, how is it called? Closed under complex conjugation. So as a set, it should be equal to the complex conjugate, set of the complex conjugate rapidities. In other words, we should have always pairs of complex conjugate rapidities plus real rapidities, some number of real rapidities. This is a strong statement that is proven by Vladimirov. Already in Vladimirov in 1986. I have the reference, I can look it up. I don't put here in, but if you want, I can look it up. Now, second important statement has to do with SU2 symmetry. And let me explain some things here, because we forgot about SU2 symmetry. I mean, the Hamiltonian is SU2 invariant. This is very clear. However, we chose a particular basis and we constructed our eigenstates starting from the ferromagnetic state pointing in the Z direction. So we chose just a specific vacuum state such that we can construct our eigenstates. Now, what about the SU2 symmetry property of these states? I mean, it is a statement that if you have a solution to the beta equations, again, with some rapidity such that every particle is finite. Every rapidity is finite. I will explain a little bit more what is the opposite, when can we have infinite rapidities. So if every rapidity is finite and we have a solution to the beta equations, then the state that you get from this coordinate beta ansatz is actually a highest weight state with respect to SU2 symmetry. So what does this mean? I will show, draw another diagram just to be very, very clear about the picture what we have. So I will draw here SZ, total SZ, and eigenvalues of total SZ for different states. So we have the zero. I mean, SZ0 is half filling. When we are at half filling, we can imagine that we have even, for example. Then there are states which are at half filling. And then somehow here is up And here is down, heat up is the total, the ferromagnetic state in total spin equals to L over 2, and here minus L over 2. So these are ferromagnetic states with all spins pointing up, and here is all spins pointing down. No particles, and every side is occupied by a particle. And then we, when we construct beta states with a small number of entities, now somehow we are making some small steps from the ferromagnetic vacuum states down, downwards, so to say. But there is also another possibility to go downwards using the SU2 symmetry. So there are the overall spin raising and spin, spin lowering and spin raising operators, which are given as sum over J, spin lowering J, and sum over J, spin raising at that side J. But these are actually, the Pauli matrices in spin 1/2 representation. And using the global spin lowering operators, you can also come lower and lower. Using global spin raising operators, you can go up. And the statement is that if you have a beta Ansatz state, it is a higher state state, which means that if you act with S plus, it is annihilated. So the condition is that S plus acting on any beta Ansatz state is zero. So you cannot go up. And this gives a characterization about the beta states. What and the SU2 symmetries, and also it is a characterization about how many solutions you can get for a particular n. So for a particular n and a particular l, how many solutions you can get? You need to count the number of highest weight states corresponding to the given S set. And then there will be also the states which are not highest weight states. So there will be some states where which you obtain by acting on some states in up in the upper parts. You act with spin lowering operators, and then you get come to lower and lower levels, and then it's not the highest rate state anymore, and they are also there. So, for example, you can get if you have a vacuum state, it's L over two. If you have a one particle state, then it's L over two minus one, the value of SZ, because you have one downspin. But then, if you have single particles, which are here in this beta Ansatz, then they all have this, but there is also a state which is obtained from this one simply by acting on acting with the spin lowering operator. And then the question is, what type of state is it? It cannot be a beta Ansatz state with finite number of rapidities, finite rapidities, because this is a statement, and this statement is proven using algebraic beta Ansatz. So I don't think it is very easy to see from this coordinate beta Ansatz. You need the so-called algebraic machinery to understand this statement. So I just put it here so that that you know about the structure of solutions and the combinatorics. I think to prove it with coordinate beta Ansatz is more difficult. Yes, and then one more curiosity before we move on. This curiosity is simply that the spin lowering operator, the global spin lowering operator S minus, actually corresponds to adding an infinite rapidity to the coordinate beta Ansatz. I mean, this is a curious thing, and I really put this as a homework, because this is a nice homework. So somehow previous times when I said homework, it was maybe a boring thing to check or substitute one thing into another thing, but this is a nice homework. So you should look at the coordinate beta Ansatz wave function and think a little bit, and you should think that what happens when we have a solution with finite rapidities, but then we add one more rapidity, like n plus one, which is an infinite rapidity formally. So I just take somehow an infinite limit of finite rapidities. And then you should look at the wave function and understand that it is obtained from the earlier wave function by acting with the spin lowering operator. This is a nice exercise. And you can already check it at one particle level, or two particle level, or three particle, not necessarily to substitute the most general. Already for one particle, as you can actually very easily see. But it's a nice exercise. I'm not giving any further details about this. And also, infinite rapidities. I'm not saying anything more. I'm sorry. I'm leaving it completely for homework. Okay. I don't want to spoil anything. Maybe somebody will actually think about it. Okay. And then further statement, which is a really big and strong statement. I did it this. So further statement is, I write it out, statement three, that Bethe Ansatz is complete. Okay, so now this is a very strong statement, and lots of people spend a lot of papers, proving it under certain circumstances or analyzing it. It means that if you do the Bethe Ansatz and you also allow for these infinite rapidities, what we had earlier, then you can construct all the states in their Hilbert states. Maybe if you say that you only want to look at higher state states, then you forget about infinite rapidities, you just take finite rapidities. Statement is, you get all the states, so it is a complete description of the full Hilbert space. It's very important property. People are really interested in the full dynamics, and if you want to have the full dynamics of correlation functions, non-equilibrium dynamics, whatever, then you really need to know that there are no states, no eigenstates missed, and this Bethe Ansatz method should be complete. And as far as I know, maybe some experts can correct me, but as far as I know, there is no completely rigorous proof of this for the XXX model. There are some kind of partial proofs, or maybe there is a proof by Tarasov and Balchenko, but I'm not completely sure, what they actually prove. So the completeness of Bethe Ansatz is a very difficult problem. In some cases, when you make some simplifications, then you can prove it. For the Liebig-Nigger model, which I have not yet treated, which is the topic of Andrea Trombettoni, if a coupling constant is bigger than zero, you will see, then it is proven by a guy called Dorlas. And then it's a rigorous proof that Bethe Ansatz is completely finite volume. But for spin chains, it is a very messy thing. And let me show you one more example why it is completely messy, and why many people spend time on analyzing solutions, because there are the so-called exact two strings, which is two strings, which is a special type of singular solution. And it's just an example of many type of interesting things for the behavior of beta roots, what you can have. So it's just a special peculiar property for the XXX model, but in some other versions, we have similar things also for other models, like XXX extinction or something. It turns out that for XXX model in finite volume L, you can have cases when you have some rapidities, finite rapidities in your model, and then you have extra two rapidities, I over two and minus I over two. And this is an exact two string. So when I plot them, then somewhere are the other rapidities, but these extra two rapidities are just here, and there is no string deviation. And the peculiar property about this is that it is a very special state, which is very singular in many respects. For example, if I just put beta equations, if I just take two particles, so I just take the exact two string. These are my two rapidities. If I substitute to beta equations, what do I get? For example, I choose this is lambda one, and I choose this is lambda two. Then I get I over two minus I over two over I over two plus I over two to the power of L, multiplied by, this will also die. I don't know if it is dead or anyway, I will go to black. Multiplied by the scattering phase factor. And this I obtain by, I put here I, because lambda one minus lambda two is I. And then here I put plus I over I minus I. And this is equal to one. And you see that it is something like zero to the power of L multiplied by one over zero or something like this. So it's a completely singular beta equation. And you could even argue that this is complete nonsense. You cannot have it because, the beta equation doesn't make sense. But it turns out that when you go really and sit down and look at the wave function and what it is, such a thing exists, such a solution to beta equations exists, but not in this form, but when you multiply, it makes some regularization, blah, blah, blah. And this corresponds to a very simple wave function. It corresponds to two particles tied completely strongly together, such that they can only move together. So the bound state is infinitely tied together. And the wave function is the following. Where should I write it? Well, I can delete it. I will write it now here. The wave function corresponding to the exact two string is C of x1 and x2 is, I write it like this. I put here a reference state. It is easier to write it like this. sum over j minus 1 to the power of j, and then a spin over ring operator at j and spin over ring operator at j plus 1. I mean, this is a simple way of writing it. So two particles move together, and when they move together, then there is a propagation phase equal to minus 1. And clearly, this can only exist if L is even, because we go around and these minus 1s should cancel when we take the boundary conditions. And this was an example. So why was I saying this? It was an example to show you that very singular things can happen. And when you want to analyze completeness of beta ansatz, then somehow you would need to treat all of these singular cases separately. And when you go to access that spin chain at special points, even worse things happen. So it's a complete mess. And then what sometimes people do, they go to other methods and they make a little bit modification of the model. They introduce inhomogeneities or twists, et cetera, and then you can prove completeness. But generally, it is a difficult problem.
Sorry, do you mean analytically, right? The Bethe ansatz is complete if you can find the whole spectra of the Hamiltonian analytically, not numerically, right?
I mean, what I mean is that you can take every eigenstate of your model in a good basis. I mean, when you get rid of all possible degeneracies, and then every eigenstate should be expressed using the beta ansatz wave function with an appropriate values of lambdas. This is what I mean. Is it okay? I'm not sure I understand.
Yeah. What I don't know if you can call the Bethe ansatz complete even if you find the spectra numerically. It's not, right?
Well, yes. This is a matter of what you call a proof or what you call completeness. I mean, there is a method called separation of variables, which exists when you have inhomogeneities around the spin chain in an algebraic formulation, you have some twists. So you need to make modifications to the model, and then in a good basis, you can actually prove completeness analytically. But this is a special method, and it does not apply directly to this Hamiltonian. But if you make some modifications, you make the problem easier, more general in some sense, but still easier, then you can prove it analytically. So you are right that what I was saying here is not completely analytic. There is one method called separation of variables when you do it analytically. Is it good?
So,
translated in simpler terms, this just means that the Bethe states are a basis for the fully reversed space, right?
Yes.
This is thank you.
So, is it complete for all models, like for XXZ, XX, XYZ?
Well, so far we don't know counterexamples, but as I said, I mean, this is a very interesting research. I mean, for me. I don't know what it means. I mean, maybe it's physically not so interesting, but from a mathematical point, it's very interesting that many times people come up with certain states, which are special states, and it is not clear how they fit into the Bethe ansatz. It's not clear what type of singular Bethe roots they have. But in each case, it was found that there is a specific choice of Bethe roots such that it is good. I mean, this is my answer. So far, there are no counterexamples, but it's a very interesting research that Each case, which should be, it seems like it's a counterexample, but then people look and spend some months, or I don't know, maybe just some weeks, and then they figure out that it is not a counterexample, and then they publish a paper that, come on, this is also Bethe ansatz. This is happening.
So you're saying that there's no complete proof, but there's no counterexample.
Yes, exactly. I will actually show you one paper in a little bit moment, maybe after a short break. There is a paper by Dexter, which is just about this, that he takes all claims of problems with Bethe ansatz, and for all claims, he gives an explanation using Bethe ansatz. It's a very good paper, very, very interesting, and a paper to enjoy. I will look for it later, okay?
Okay.
So far about...
Sorry, Balázs, may I ask a question?
Yes, sure.
So as far as I understand, if I give you one state expressed in, I don't know, in the sigma z basis of XXX, there is no an algorithm to get its decomposition in terms of Bethe states?
It's a good question. I mean, what I do usually is if I do exact linearization and I want to find something like this, then I would not do exact diagonalization of Hamiltonian. Instead, I would add other operators like higher charges to it. We will talk about higher charges a little bit later, such that higher charges completely split degeneracies. Because the problem is that, I mean, there are lots of degeneracies, and not only Zeeman degeneracy. So clearly, you have degeneracies because you act with spin-overing operators, then you are still there. But with magnetic field, you can split it. But then there are also degeneracies like you can have a state, and you can have a parity reflected state in space, right? Right? You make a space reflection. It has the same energy. And then you should separate them. And then I don't know what is the good algorithm. I did this in my research many times. I just add the operators to H, like higher charges, or I take the transfer matrix and I diagonalize the transfer matrix. There is a statement that the spectrum of the transfer matrix is simple. And this is proven rigorously by Tarashov-Varchenko. And this is a very strong statement for X66. So for the spectrum of transfer matrix, the only degeneracy is the spin lowering. But apart from spin lowering, it is non-degenerate. And then this is useful.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and we have maybe 15 minutes or something like this remaining, because I think we started later. And I give a promise that a little bit later, actually tomorrow we will go and we will try to understand why the beta ansatz works. I mean, this is really, I mean, not clear. I mean, now we have this exact solution, and we look at it, we check it, that it is a good solution, it's okay, it works. But then it's not clear why it works. And tomorrow we will start and investigate a little bit deeper why it works. This has to do with conserved charges which are there in the system, which somehow explain this vectorized scattering. We will go there tomorrow. But for the moment, for the remaining 15 minutes, I want to speak a little bit about other models. So far we only treated X66 model. What about other models? What about the general idea behind beta ansatz? I want to explain this. So the statement is that there is a large class of models that the beta ansatz wave function gives an exact solution in finite volume. And it always looks like this. It always looks like this, that you have a wave function given and defined on some coordinates, where you make a special ordering between the coordinates, such that it has the form what we had earlier. Now I will write it all in one line because I need space, maybe. You had it earlier. So we have a summation over permutations, sigma element of permutation group. Now I will write it something e to the I p of lambda, but which lambda? P of lambda of sigma j, sorry. And this is multiplied by x of j. And we have it's not enough space. Sorry. I have a summation over j also. E to the I sum over j p of lambda and sigma j, permuted lambdas multiplied by xj. And then we have this factor of product of j smaller than k, sigma j bigger than sigma k. So when there was an exchange, and then s lambda j minus lambda k, what we had earlier. And this is a beta state, which depends on set of probabilities lambda 1, etc., lambda n, all together. And what is the data, physical data, in this beta state? The physical data is two things. One is, what is the momentum function as a function of the probability? The other data is, what is S, the scattering phase? I also denote it sometimes with E to the I delta. So what is this function expressed using probabilities? And the third physical data, which is, I mean, not completely independent, but I will just say in a moment. The third physical data is about energy eigenvalues. The statement is that many models, this is an exact wave function with energy given by sum over j from 1 to n, E of lambda j. And then the third physical function, so to say, is E of lambda. What is it? Is a question. And of course, the replicability parameter is a little bit arbitrary. So that in terms of physical properties, there is only just two functions. So two functions, what is E as a function of P, and what is S as a function of P, as a function of two P variables. So this is the physical data, but it is very advantageous to express everything using replities. In a number of models, we see that S is a function of replicity differences. And then it is very convenient to treat it like this using replicity differences. So this is a general form of Bethe ansatz, a simple form of Bethe ansatz. There are actually more complicated forms for models where excitations have an inner degree of freedom. This we will treat, I believe we can treat it on the in the last lecture. It's called the nested Bethe ansatz. We will treat some parts of it. But now I want to make some, give you some examples for other models which have this structure. So not only x66, we treat x66, but not only x66 has this structure. And the first obvious example is XXZ spin chain. So you remember that for the XXZ spin chain, what did we have? I mean, the Hamiltonian was almost, not like this, but almost in the SU2 invariant case, but there was delta coupling constant in front of the SZ, SZ coupling. And delta is called anisotropy. So there's, maybe I did write it down, not so complicated. So this was Hamiltonian. Sum over J, S X terms, S Y terms, plus the S Z term, with anisotropy delta. And this has the same type of solution, but when you go to one particle and two particle problem, then you can figure out what are these functions. I mean, the figuring out what is the replicity is actually not trivial. I mean, it was a separate research paper. I mean, I don't remember, maybe in the 60s. I can look it up if somebody really wants. But there was a separate research paper where somebody found out what is the good replicity parameterization. It is not so obvious. But what is easy to express A using P or S using P? Finding good replicity parameterization is more difficult. In any case, I will now show you the answer. So for example, if delta is bigger than one, then we can parameterize delta as cosine hyperbolic of some eta. Where eta is a real parameter, and then we can use this eta parameter to give a good representation of these functions. So the final answer is the following. I should represent e to the I p lambda, so one particle scattering, one particle propagation phase as sinus of lambda minus I eta over 2 over sinus lambda plus I eta over 2. Then the energy function is found to be minus sinh squared beta over 2 sine of lambda minus sinus of lambda minus I eta over 2, then sinus lambda plus I eta over 2. And the S matrix as a function of replicity difference is the following. It is sine sinus of lambda minus I, no, cannot write, lambda minus I eta, now plus I eta over sinus lambda minus I eta. And I mean, this is, I can say that this is left for homework. It is not a nice homework, but you can still do it if you want, to check that if you take these functions and you go to two particle level, already at two particle level, that you can check that this is a good solution. I mean, this is a good solution using these functions. And then you can convince yourself that what we were doing here with three particles, it also carries over. So this was XXZ model for delta bigger than one. For delta smaller than one, we have a similar situation when we replace sin by sinh, and we parameterize delta is equal to cosinus maybe of gamma. So maybe this parameter is often used. I can make a statement without going to details that the string solutions depend very strongly on this delta. I will not analyze it because this would be a matter of another lecture and I don't have time for all types of lectures. I mean, for x66 model, SU2 symmetric x66 model, we have this statement that strings can be arbitrarily long. So we can have n strings of that n goes from 1 to infinity. However, this is not always true. So if we have delta bigger than 1, it turns out that we can have strings with arbitrary length, where again, where the, I mean, if I draw, then the this difference in the imaginary direction will be I eta. Now, if we have delta smaller than one, it's just a statement, then we have this situation, and then we will have strings where the difference is I gamma in the imaginary direction. But now the possibilities for strings is very much limited, and it's a very complicated issue. It depends on the ratio of gamma to pi, and it's a very complicated it's a very complicated story. I mean, I should write, well, I don't have time to go into details. I just write that the number of allowed strings depends on I did not write it. The number of allowed strings depends on gamma, and it's actually. But it's a good story, so I will just say this, that I write gamma is pi times p over q, and then this p and q, they can be integers, and if they are really integers, then the number of allowed strings depends very strongly on what these integers are. And this is a long story. It can be found in the book of Takahashi. And I mean, here it's a funny, I want to mention a funny thing. I have time for this. Before we move on, that this story of what types of strings are allowed in the Bethe Ansatz solution of the model is a problem which was a surprising problem even to experts when they first analyzed this. So I want to put some links here, because actually it's a funny historical story. So there was a paper by Minoru Takahashi, who is, I mean, one of the top experts in this area. I put it here to text box, where he computed the thermodynamics of one-dimensional Heisenberg model for delta or delta absolute value smaller than one. And he made some assumptions about possibilities for string solutions. Now, there was a little bit later a paper in the same journal by Johnson, McCoy, and Lai. I will put it here. You can read the abstract when you click on it. When they computed high temperature expansion, and they said that they don't know what is wrong with Takahashi's paper, they completely don't know, but the high temperature expansion of the result of Takahashi is simply wrong. High temperature expansion of free energy is possible using the standard statistical physical theory methods. It's a very standard thing. They computed it and they said it's wrong. And then there was one more paper by Takahashi and also Suzuki with title Reply to the comments of Johnson et al. On thermodynamics of Heisenberg Ising ring. I put the link here. And then they corrected the assumption, and then they figured out what is the correct string content, what is the correct, so to say, particle content, bound state content for these models. So it's a nice story that at that time this was really not clear, and they had to go through this series of papers to figure it out. But now it is common knowledge. So now we understand what are the strings. The whole point why I was saying it is that it's a very complicated thing, and sometimes people would say that it has even physical consequences for non-equilibrium dynamics. I don't know. It should be a topic when we discuss generalized hydrodynamics. I don't have time for it. I just say that there are some physical quantities, or maybe what we can call physical, like the so-called Drude weight for transport. Spin transport, where it shows some kind of fractal behavior depending on this value of gamma. So it's a not continuous function using of gamma, but I'm not sure if it's a physical quantity, and it's a topic for a separate discussion. I just wanted to put it here for those people who know a little bit about it. Okay, and before we close today, I just mentioned the Lie-Wiedegger model. So I erased this one. I added the wave function there. So the Lie-Wiedegger model is a completely different type of model. It is not a spin chain. It is a continuum model of interacting particles where Bose particles can move on a line. So then it's really not a spin chain. Particles really move on a continuous space. We imagine, again, periodic boundary conditions. And we can write down Hamiltonian using a first quantized form or second quantized form, whatever we prefer. The key step is that there should be an interaction between particles where the potential energy is proportional to Dirac delta. So it's an approximation. We call it the delta function interacting Bose guys. there, the lambda function interacting both the graphs. I mean, sometimes for short, it is just called 1D Pozsgay, or another name is Liebiger model, because they were the first ones to solve it. And this is the topic of Andrea Trombettoni's lecture course, so I will not give too many details about it, just some statement about the Bethe Ansatz wave function without proof, because we have time for this one. So first I should write down what is Hamiltonian. I will write it in second quantized form. So in second quantized form, Hamiltonian is given over an integral density, integral of operator densities, where we have in second quantized form Bose field operators. So I have a field operator C, big C, I write like this, of X, and also it's a joint C dagger of X, second quantized form. I mean, they satisfy canonical Bose commutation rules. Like if I, this is y, then this is delta x minus y, and I should think about I should think about the sign. I always forget which sign. I should think. I'm sorry. Here it's either plus or minus. I didn't think about it. But usually Bose commutation rules, and Hamiltonian is the following. We have a kinetic energy term, which is delta x psi dagger of x and dx psi of x. Plus we have potential energy term. I write it like this. C is a coupling constant, and potential energy is, I write it like this, psi dagger x, psi dagger of x, and psi of x, psi of x. Now this is Hamiltonian, altogether this is Hamiltonian density. I mean, this is second quantized form, but in first quantized form, it really just means that we have a two-body interaction proportional to delta function. And it turns out that this model is solved by Bethe Ansatz, but now there's an important difference. The important difference is that the Bethe Ansatz wave function here has this restriction for coordinates, but as we know that the wave function of bosonic models are completely symmetric in X. Completely symmetric. So the question is, how do we relate the two things? Well, the statement is just that if you want to have the wave function of this Liebiger model at any kind of x1, etc., xn, then you first make a permutation so that you permute the coordinates to get to an ordered set. And for the ordered set, you will have this representation as an exact representation. In other cases, you would just permute the x coordinates back. And then for this particular model, it turns out that lambda is just equal to p. So you can choose the true one particle momentum as the relativity variable. Then the energy function in this normalization as a function of momentum is just p squared. And the scattering function, scattering factor, scattering amplitude, s as a function of relativity difference is p minus ic over p plus ic. So I think this will be treated by Andrea Trombettoni. Let me just give a comment that C can be bigger than one, or C can be also smaller than one. Both cases are possible, both cases are important. Physical behavior is really different. In this case, for C bigger than one, in the model, we only have one strings. So this is called repulsive, because now delta function is repulsive, of repulsive sign. So Particles cannot form bound states, but for C smaller than zero, it is attractive. The delta function is attractive, and particles can form bound states. So you can have n strings of any n. So similar to E66 model, arbitrary number of particles can form a single bound state. And I think we are just at the end of time, so that's it for today.
Thank you.
Questions? I mean, maybe somebody has a question. Meanwhile, let me just find, I mean, this is really takes a matter of 1 minute to find this paper by Baxter, because it is saved for me. I also want to put it in the Yes, here it is. I knew it was not would not take long. So you can look here. This paper is called Completeness of the Bethe Ansatz for the 6 and 8 vertex models. I mean, 8 vertex model is X, Y, Z spin chain, which is a little bit more complicated. But you can look here. I mean, what Baxter does is he takes examples where people would claim that Bethe Ansatz is not complete with special outlier states, so to say, and then he shows one by one that it is complete and everything is described by Bethe Ansatz. It's a funny, very entertaining paper, I would say. Any questions?
Okay, yes, I have a question. And, yeah. So I missed the precise statement probably of the string hypothesis. Are we assuming that all of the solutions have this string are arranged in strings? Because I think you said that there are some examples of solutions that are not really arranged in strings.
Yes, I think it's a good question. I think I forgot to go back to this.
Forse aperta, eh?
Okay, maybe Capelli is, okay, thank you. So the statement is that if you want to describe the dynamics in the thermodynamic limit, then it is completely enough to assume this string hypothesis and describe your states in terms of strings. However, there will be some kind of states which can show different behavior. For example, I mean, it also depends really on the string deviation. So you know that I had this picture when I was drawing strings. I can now delete this. So I, for example, for two strings, I was saying that this difference is I. So it should be approximately at plus minus I over 2 plus the string deviations. But these string deviations can be very, very big. Or it also can happen that when you change the volume, then the two particles just come close to each other and then they repass each other and be on the reline. And then this means that the bound state is broken up. So the statement is that when you want to characterize everything and you want to count the numbers of solutions using these ideas of highest state states and how many solutions the equations have, then you will get the correct number of how many highest state states are, but you will the precise nature of the states might be somewhat different in some examples. So there will be some outlier states that the structure of the strings is a little bit different than what you would get from your predictions. So string deviations can be very large, or you would expect to have some two string, but it's actually two real rapidities or things like that can happen, or maybe some singular solutions. And the statement is that even though we have such outlier states, they do not influence the dynamics of the models when you go to thermodynamic limit. I mean, this is observed. This is observed by in many research works that we make string hypothesis assumption, we compute things, then it is correct because it agrees with the numerical approaches or whatever. But it is not rigorously proven. So I wouldn't say it is rigorous. And there are some people who are famous for trying to figure out methods that completely avoid strings. So there is a Wuppertal group of physicists, Andreas Klümper and some collaborators who really spent a lot of time developing methods called quantum transfer matrix and related methods around it, which completely avoid strings and can compute thermodynamics without strings. But I mean, these methods are also limited. So it's a problematic situation. I can summarize it like this. Is it a good answer?
Yes, thanks. It's clear enough.
Okay.
So now there is the.
May I ask a question, please?
Yes.
Yeah. Why don't we take a 5-minute break and then we have a discussion session,
or it's together, okay with me.
Together with the other speaker? Or you want to ask a question immediately now?
I don't know. I can ask and then.
Yes. Okay. Ask your question. We have a break.
Okay. Thanks.
A small break, and then we have a discussion session with Colm as well.
Okay. So my question maybe is a bit strange, but why beta roots live on a complex plane? Can we put them on some other manifold?
Okay. This is a good question, and I know some answer, but let us go to break. Okay.